Homeward bound.
No, ho, 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 ho,
sickle and lamp and stave. But the happiest hour a sailor sees is when he's down in an inland town with his Nancy on his knee. Yo-ho! And his arm a lamp of ways.
Get back the captain, off we go, and the sailor's home.
Of ballad songs and snatches, and dreamy lullaby, and dreamy
reprieved at the last moment and raised to the exalted rank of Lord High Executioner under the following remarkable circumstances.
A great Mikado, virtuous man, when he to rule a plan began, resolved to try a plan whereby a man may so he decreed in words succinct that all who flirted near the wind, unless connubially linked, should forthwith be
pretext, but then meant to be mown up, and made him headsman for
myself was next to be decapitated, and not cut off another's head until he's cut his own up, his own up, his own up, until he's cut his own off.
Family pride is something inconceivable. I can't help it, I was born sneering. But I struggle hard to overcome this defect. When all of the officers of the company resigned in a body because they were too proud to serve under an next table, did I not unhesitatingly accept all of their posts at once?
And all the salaries that went with them.
It is consequently my degrading duty to serve this upstart as chairman of the board, managing director, chief operating executive, treasurer, secretary, head barman, chief cook and bottle washer, all into one, and that a salary, approval or pay for his services, my salaried minion. But I do it, it revolts me, but I do it.
And it does you credit.
I also retail the company's secrets at a very low figure. For instance, any further information about Yum Yum would come under the head of a company secret. Another insult, I think. Underline them.
Young man, despair, likewise go to Yum Yum, the fair you must not woo. This will not go, I'm sorry for you, you very imperfect ablution of this very day from school, Yum Yum. Will wend her way and homeward come with beat of gum and a rum tum tum to wed the Lord High Executioner. And the brass will crash, and the trumpets pray, and the curtain dash on their wedding day. She'll toddle away, us all of her, with the Lord High Executioner.
And the brass will crash, and the trumpets pray, and the curtain dash on their wedding day.
And the trumpets pray, and the curtain dies on their wedding day.
but I journeyed to the land of Delhi to find that young, young whom I love so dearly. This day to Coco is to be united.
The fact appears to be as you recited. But here he comes, equipped as suits his station. He'll give you any further
to the heights that few can scale. Save my long and weary dances, surely never had a male. Under such like circumstances, so adventurous a tale, which may rank with most romances, taken from a county jail.
Taken from a county jail.
By a set of curious chances, surely never had a male. So offenders who might well be underground and who never would be missed, who never would be missed. There's the pestilential nuisances who write for autographs, or people who have flabby hands and irritating laughs, or children who are up in dates and floor you with them flat, or persons who in shaking hands shake hands with you like that, and all third persons who on spoiling tater dates insist. They'd none of them be missed, they'd none of them be missed.
He's got them on the list. He's got them on the list, and they're gonna be missed.
There's the Big Brother contestants and the others of their class, pop idol vocalists, I've got them on the list. Alternative comedians who never make you laugh, they'd none of them be missed, they'd none of them be missed. And the celebs in the jungle shouting, get me out of here, whose only aim in life is spending cash and drinking beer. The footballer from Wilred, whose wife is quite the thing, who looks well on the catwalk, but she really shouldn't sing. And that singular phenomenon, the strident feminist, I'm sure she'd not be missed. I don't think she'd be missed.
He's got her on the list. He's got her on the list. And I'm sure she'd not be missed. I'm sure.
irritating nuisance who just now is rather rife. The tabloid journalist had got him on the list. Reporters and photographers invading private life. They'd none of them be missed. They'd none of them be missed. And the crony politicians of a sycophantic kind, such as, what you call him, Thing Me Bob, and likewise, never mind. And Michael H. and Charlie K., and also Tony, who? The task of filling up the blanks I'd rather leave to you, but it really doesn't matter who you put upon the list, for they'd none of them be missed. They'd none of them be missed.
You may put them on the list, you may put them on the list, and they'd none of them be missed.
For my approaching marriage is the last a week. I want to do them handsomely, and I want to consult you as to the amount of money I ought to spend on them.
Well, certainly. In which of my capacities? Chairman of the board, managing director, company secretary, legal counsel, treasurer, or private secretary?
Oh, suppose we say private secretary.
Speaking as your private secretary, I should say that, as the club will have to pay for it, don't stint yourself. Do it well.
Exactly, as the club will have to pay for it. That's your advice.
As private secretary, of course, you will understand that as treasurer, I am bound to see that due economy is observed.
But you said just now...
Don't stint yourself. Do it well.
As private secretary.
And now you say that due economy must be observed.
As treasurer.
I see. Come over here where the treasurer can't hear us. Now, as my solicitor, how do you propose that I should deal with this difficulty?
Oh, as your solicitor, I shall have no hesitation in saying, chances.
Oh, thank you, I will!
If it were not that as the head of legal services, I am bound to see that the law isn't violated.
I see. Come over here where the head of legal services can't hear us. Now then, as chairman of the board.
Of course, Mr. Chairman of the Board, I could propose a special vote that would cover all expenses. If it were not that, as shareholders' representative, it would be my duty to resist truth and merit. Or as company accountant, I could so walk the accounts that, as independent auditor, I should never discover the fraud. But then, as visiting chaplain of the Titipu Club, it would be my duty to denounce my dishonesty, give myself into my own custody as head of security.
Oh, that's extremely awkward.
I don't say that all these distinguished people couldn't be square, but it is right to tell you that they would be sufficiently degraded in their own estimation unless they were insulted with a very considerable pride.
Oh, well, the matter shall have my careful consideration, but my pride and her sister, and any little compliment of your part, such as an abject grovel, would be esteemed a great favour.
No money, no grovel.
Thank you. going to embrace me before all these people?
Well, that was the general idea.
Seems odd, doesn't it?
It's rather peculiar.
I expect it's all right. Must have a beginning, you know. Well, of course, I know nothing about these things, but I've no objection. It's usual.
Oh, it's quite usual, I think, eh, Private Secretary?
I have known it done.
Ah, yes.
Oh. Goodness, that's over. Well, that's never you. Oh, tell us something else we can see.
I beg your pardon, will you introduce me?
Oh, it's only nice to meet
you. One at a time, if you please.
Oh, please, this is the gentleman who used to play so beautifully on the marine parade.
Yes, I think that was the name of the instrument.
Sir, I have the misfortune to love your ward, young man. Oh, I know I deserve your anger.
Anger? Not a bit of it, my boy. Well, I love the girl myself. Charming little thing, isn't she? Nice to have my opinion backed up by a competent authority. Thank you very much. Goodbye. Get rid of it.
I beg your pardon. What is this? Customer come to trial. Oh.
That is a local bigwig here.
Oh, it's alive.
Go away, little girls. Can't talk to little girls like you. Go away.
Poobah, allow me to introduce you. These are my three wards. The one in the middle is my bride-elect.
What do you want me to do to them? Mind, I will not kiss them.
No. You shan't kiss them. A little bow, a mere nothing. You needn't mean it.
It goes against the grain. They are not young ladies, they are young persons.
Oh, come on, make an effort. There's a good nobleman.
Well, I shan't mean it. How do you do, little girls? How do you do? Oh, my protoplasmosis.
Oh, that's very good.
I see nothing to laugh at. It is very painful to have to say, how do you do, little girls? How do you do to young persons? I am not in the habit of saying, how do you do, little girls? How do you do to anyone under the rank of the stockbroker.
Oh, don't laugh at him. He can't help it. He's under treatment for it. Oh, never mind then. They don't understand the delicacy of your position.
We know how delicate it is, don't we?
Indeed, I think we should. How a person of your importance can do it at all is something I never can, never shall understand.
Modified much.
That's why you can't refuse him.
What good would that do? He wouldn't let me marry you. And besides, a wandering minstrel plays a wind instrument outside public houses is hardly a fitting husband to ward for Lord High Executioner.
But shall I tell her? Yes, she will not be safe with you.
What if it should prove that, after all, I am no musician?
There. I was certain of it directly I heard you play.
What if it should prove that I am none other than the son of His Excellency the Mikado?
The son of the Mikado? Why are you so disguised? What have you done? Will you promise never to do it again?
Some years ago, I had the misfortune to capture Lady Catisham, an elderly lady of my father's aunterage, and she claimed me in marriage under my father's rule. He insisted that I marry her within a week or perish ignominiously on the scaffold. That night, I fled, and assuming the disguise of a second trombone, I joined the band in which I had the happiness of seeing you.
Oh, I think if you please, you'd better not come too near. The laws against flirting are excessively severe.
But we're quite alone and nobody can see us.
Still, that don't make it right. Flirt is capital.
It is capital.
We must obey the law.
Oh, please take the law.
I wish it could, but it won't.
If it were not for the law, how happy we might be.
Happy indeed.
If it were not for the law, we should now be sitting side by side. Like that.
Oh, we should have been obliged to stand half a mile off like that.
We should be gazing into each other's eyes. Like that.
Breathing sighs of unutterable love.
Oh!
Like that.
With our arms around each other's waists. Like that.
If it wasn't for the law.
If it wasn't for the law.
As it is, of course, we couldn't do anything of the kind.
Not for worlds.
Being engaged to Coco, you know.
Being engaged to Coco.
Were you not to Coco plighted, I would say in tender tone, love and love.
You have interrupted an apostrophe, sir.
It's a text message from His Excellency the Mikado.
A message from the Mikado? What on earth can he have to say to me? Here it is at last. I thought it would come sooner or later. Tamuk is struck by... The Mikado is struck by the fact that no executions have taken place at the Titipu Club for over a year, and decrees that unless someone is beheaded within a month, the post of Lord High Executioner will be abolished, and the club reduced in level to that of a public house.
That'll involve us all in irretrievable ruin.
Oh, well, there's nothing for it. I shall have to execute somebody at once. The only question is, who shall it be?
Well, it seems unkind to say so, but as you're already under sentence of death, everything seems to point to you.
To me? What are you talking about? I can't execute myself.
Why not?
Why not? Because in the first place, self-decapitation is an extremely difficult, not to say dangerous, thing to attempt. And in the second, it's suicide. And suicide is a capital offence. Besides, I don't see how a man can cut off his own head.
A man might try.
Even if you only succeed in cutting it half off, that could be something.
It would be taken as an earnest of your desire to comply with the wishes of the head.
No, no, pardon me. On that point, I am adamant. As official headhunter, my reputation is at stake. And I cannot consent to embark on a professional operation unless I can see a successful result.
This professional conscientiousness is highly creditable to you, but it places us in a very awkward position.
My good sir, the awkwardness of your position is grace itself compared with that of a man in the act of trying to cut off his own head.
I'm afraid unless you can obtain a substitute...
A substitute? Why, nothing easier! Ah! Puma! I appoint you Lord High Substitute.
I should be delighted. Such an appointment would realise my fondest dreams. But no, at any sacrifice, I must set bounds to my insatiable ambition. I am so proud, if I allowed my family pride to be my guide. I volunteer to quit this sphere instead of you in a minute or two. But family pride must be denied and set aside and mortified and mortified.
To sit with some silence in a pestilential prison and awaiting the cessation of the cheapest chimichanga.
to benefit my kith and kin, are now required to die within a month. And that by a man whom I have loaded with honours. Is this public gratitude? Is this... Oh, go away, sir. How dare you? Can't you see I'm soliloquizing?
Go on, don't mind me.
What are you going to do with that rope?
I'm about to terminate an unendurable existence because you are going to marry the girl I adore.
Oh, nonsense. I won't permit it, sir, and if you try anything of the kind, I shall order your immediate arrest. Come, sir, desist at once.
Set up, sir. If you attempt to raise the alarm, I shall at once perform the hurry dispatch with this dagger.
No! Cold-blooded scoundrel. Are you aware that in committing suicide you are committing a crime which is punishable by... Yes. Substitute.
What's the matter?
Is it absolutely certain that you're resolved to die?
Absolutely.
Will nothing break your resolution?
Nothing.
Threats, entreaties, prayers, all useless...
All, my mind is made up.
Then if you really mean what you say, don't spoil yourself by committing suicide. Would be handsomely beheaded by the public executioner.
I don't see how that would benefit me.
You don't? Now observe. You'll have a month to live, and you'll live like a fighting cock at my expense. When the time comes, there'll be a grand ceremonial. You'll be the central figure. No one will want to deprive you of that distinction. There'll be a procession. Bands playing. Dead march. Bells tolling. All the girls in tears. Yum yum! Distracted! And then, when it's all over, a great celebration and a display of fireworks in the evening. You won't see them, of course, but they'll be there all the same.
Do you think Yum Yum would really be distracted at my death?
Why, I'm convinced of it. Bless you, she's the most tender-hearted creature alive.
I would hate to cause her pain. Perhaps. If I were to withdraw from the club and back in the Far East for a year or two, I could contrive to forget her.
Oh, I don't think you could forget Yum Yum quite so easily. And after all, what is worse than a love-blighted life? A life without Yum Yum? Why, it seems absurd.
And yet there are a good many people who have to endure it.
Yes, poor devils. You are quite right not to be one of their number.
I shan't be of their number.
Noble fellow!
I'll tell you how you manage it. You let me marry Yum Yum tomorrow, and in a month, you may be heavy.
No. I draw the line with Yum Yum.
Very well, if you can draw the line, so can I.
No, stop. Now, be reasonable. How can I consent to your marrying Yum Yum if I'm going to marry her myself?
My good friend, you'll be our widow in a month, and you can marry her then.
Yes, I quite see that, but... Oh, dear me, my position over the next month will be most unpleasant, most unpleasant.
Not half so unpleasant as my position at the end of it.
Oh, very well. I consent. After all, it's only postponing my marriage for a month. But you won't prejudice her against me, will you? She's been taught to regard me as a wise and good man, and I shouldn't like her views on that point disturbed.
Trust me, she will never learn the truth from me.
Tis nanky-poo. am young Sir Glendon. Now I adore that girl with passion tender, and would not yield her with a ready will, or her a lot, if I did not adore myself with passion tender still. With passion tender still.
Thank you. Despite bravado,
quite artless way, why it is that I am so much more attractive than anybody else in the whole world. Can this be vanity? No. Nature is lovely and rejoices in her loveliness, and I am a child of nature and take after my mother.
Who says 24 hours make a day?
Well, there is a popular impression to that effect.
Then we reface it. We call each second a minute, each minute an hour, each hour a day, and each day a year. That way, we've about 30 years married happiness before us.
And at that rate, this interview has already lasted 4 hours and 3 quarters.
Yes, how time flies when one is thoroughly enjoying oneself.
That's the way to look at it. Let's not be downhearted. There's a silver lining to every cloud.
Certainly. Let's be perfectly happy.
By all means, let's thoroughly enjoy ourselves.
It's absurd to cry. Quite ridiculous.
Oh, Go on. Don't mind me.
I'm afraid they're distressing you.
Oh, no, I must get used to it. Only please do it by degrees. Begin by putting your arm around her waist. There. Oh, let me get used to that first.
Wouldn't you like to leave us? It must pain you to see us so affectionate.
No, I must learn to bear it. Now, oblige me by allowing her head to rest on your shoulder. Yeah, like that. Oh. Now, kiss her. Ooh, thank you. This is simple torture.
Come, bear up. After all, it's only for a month.
No, it's no use deluding oneself with false hopes.
What do you mean?
My child, my poor child. How am I going to put this? My little bride that was to have been.
Was to have been?
Yes, you never can be mine.
Oh, what? I'm so glad.
I've just ascertained that under the Mikado's rules, when a married man is beheaded, his wife must wear a concrete overcoat.
A concrete overcoat?
Yes, a concrete overcoat. It's a most unpleasant death.
But whom did you get that from?
Oh, from Paul Barr. He's my solicitor.
But he may have been mistaken.
Oh, so I thought. So I consulted our officers of consumer advice, environmental health, training standards, and marriage guidance. They're all of the same opinion. Never knew such unanimity on a point of law in my life.
But stop a bit. This law has never been put into force.
No, not yet. You see, flirting is the only crime punishable by decapitation. And of course, married men never flirt.
Of course they don't. I quite forgot that.
Well, I suppose I might take it that my dream of happiness is at an end. Good.
Darling, I don't want to appear selfish. And I love you with all my heart. I don't suppose I shall ever love anybody else half as much. But when I agreed to marry you, I own, I've no idea. Because in a month I'd have to wear a concrete overcoat.
Nor I. It's the very first I've heard of it.
It makes a difference, doesn't it?
It does make a difference.
You see, concrete. It's such a stuffy death.
I call it a beast of a death.
You see my difficulty, don't you?
Yes, and I see my own. If I insist on your carrying out your promise, I doom you to a hideous death. If I release you, you marry Coco at once.
Then the maiden whom you cherish must be slaughtered too. Here's a how do you do. Here's a how do you do.
Here's a pretty mess in a month or less. I must die without a wedding. Let the bitter tear I'm shedding witness my distress. Here's a pretty mess. Here's a pretty mess.
Here's a state of things. To her life she clings. Matrimonial devotion doesn't seem to suit her notion. Burial it brings. Here's a state of things. Here's a state of things.
With a passion that's intense, I worship her and I adore. But come not to common sense, we ought to do anymore. If what is said is true, 'tis that to marry you. Here's a pretty state of things. Here's a pretty how to do. Here's a pretty state of things. A pretty state of things. Here's a how do.
Here's a how do.
For if what you say is true, I cannot marry you.
Here's a pretty state of things. Here's a pretty how do do.
Thanks, old fellow. I'm sure you are.
You see, I'm really quite helpless.
I quite see that.
I can't conceive of anything more distressing than to have your marriage cancelled at the last moment. But you shan't be disappointed of a wedding. You shall come to mine.
Thanks, old boy, but that's impossible.
Why so?
Today I die.
What do you mean?
I can't live without Yum-Yum. This afternoon I performed a happy dispatch.
No, pardon me. I won't allow that.
Why not?
Why not? Why, hang it all, you're under contract to die by the hands of the public executioner. If you kill yourself, what's to become of me?
Why, I should have to be executed in your place.
It would certainly seem so.
Now then, Lord Mayor, what is it?
The Mikado and his entourage are about to enter the building and will be here in a few minutes.
The Mikado? He's coming, no doubt, to ascertain whether I've carried out his decree. Now, look here, you, this is getting serious. A bargain's a bargain, and you really mustn't frustrate the ends of justice. As a man of honour and a gentleman, you are bound to die ignominiously by the hands of the public executioner.
Very well, then. Behead me.
What? Now?
Certainly, at once.
Chop it off, Coco, chop it off.
My good sir, I don't go around being prepared to cut off gentlemen's heads at a moment's notice. Why, I've never even killed a blue bottle.
Still, as Lord High Executioner...
My good sir, as Lord High Executioner, I've got to kill him in a month. I'm not ready yet. I don't know how it's done. I'm going to take lessons. I mean to start with the guinea pig and work my way up through the animal kingdom till I come to a second trombone. Why, you don't suppose that as a humane man, I'd have accepted the post of Lord High Executioner if I hadn't thought that the duties were purely nominal. I can't kill you. I can't kill anything.
I can't kill anybody!
Come, my poor fellow. You'll have unpleasant duties to discharge at times. After all, what is it? If I don't mind, why should you? So remember, sooner or later, it must be done.
Must it? I'm not so sure about that.
What do you mean?
Why should I execute you when an affidavit that you've been beheaded will do just as well? There are plenty of witnesses. Chairman of the board, managing director, chief operating executive, treasurer, secretary, head barman and band leader.
But where are they?
There they are. They'll all swear to it, won't you?
Am I to understand that all of us company officers are required to perjure ourselves to ensure your safety?
Why not? You'll be grossly insulted as usual.
Will the insult be cashed down? Or
oh, it'll be a ready money transaction.
Well, it will be a useful discipline. Very good. Very good. Name your fiction and I'll endorse it. Our family pride, how do you like that?
But I tell you, life without Yum Yum!
Oh, Yum Yum, Yum Yum, bother Yum Yum. Here, Commissionaire, go and fetch Yum Yum. Now, take Yum Yum and marry Yum Yum. Only go away and never come back again. Ah, here she is. Yum Yum, are you particularly busy?
Not particularly.
Have you 5 minutes to spare?
Yes.
Well, go along with the registrar. He'll marry you at once.
But
now, don't ask any questions, but do as I tell you. Nanky Poo will explain all.
No,
not for worlds. The Mikado's coming. No doubt to see whether I've cut your head off. And if he finds that you're still alive, I shall have the greatest difficulty in persuading him that I've beheaded you. Close thing, that. Here he comes.
But they're nothing at all compared with those of his daughter-in-law elect.
govern each tribe and sect, all cheerfully own my sway.
Except his daughter-in-law-elect, as tough as a bone, with a will of her own, is his daughter-in-law-elect.
My nature is love and light, my freedom from all defect.
It is insignificant, quite compared with his daughter-in-law-elect.
Mikado never did in Japan exist. To nobody second, I'm certainly reckoned a true philanthropist. It is my very humane endeavor to make, to some extent, each evil liver a running river of harmless merriment. My object all sublime, I shall achieve in time, to let the punishment fit the crime, the punishment fit the crime, and make his prisoner pent, unwillingly represent, a source of innocent merriment, of innocent merriment. Rosy, dull society sinners who chatter and bleat and bore are sent to hear sermons from mystical Germans who preach from 10 to 4. The amateur tenor whose vocal villainies all desire to shirk shall during off hours exhibit his powers to Madame Tussauds waxwork. The driver who chatters on mobile phone whilst on the motorway is made to speak for a working week from a call centre based in Bombay. The yuppie who made his mint in the city by shady deals is sent to trade in his floozy, his Porsche and jacuzzi for a council house down in Brent. My object all sublime, I shall achieve in time, to let the punishment fit the crime, the punishment fit the crime, and make each prisoner bent, unwillingly represent, a source of innocent merriment, of innocent merriment. Cost airline that sends people off on tuppenny halfpenny flights goes bust while they're gone, so I'll string them along with permanent sleepless nights. The hip-hop rapper attends a series of masses and fugues and ops by cage interwoven with glass and Stockhausen, but never on top of the pops. The icy consultant whom anyone catches, the one wrapped up in red tape, must live in a cell and work like hell and not be allowed to escape, and there be tormented by virus and worms that make his computer crash, and all of his files will render him piles of work that ends up as trash.
Honored in being permitted. object of your Excellency's visit. Your wishes have been attended to. The execution has taken place.
Ah, so you've had an execution, have you?
Yes, the coroner. The coroner has just handed me his certificate.
I am the coroner.
And this is the certificate of his death? Hmm. In the car park of the Titipoo Club, in the presence of the chairman of the board, the managing director, the chief operating executive, the treasurer, the secretary, the head barman, chief cook and bottle washer.
They were all present, Your Excellency. I counted them myself.
Very good house. I wish I'd been in time for the performance.
And a tough fellow he was too. A man of gigantic strength. His struggles were terrific. Oh, it was a remarkable scene.
Mm. Describe it.
The prisoner cried as he dropped him down in a state of wild alarm. With a frightful, frantic, fearful frown, I bared my big right arm. I seized him by his little pigtail, and on his knees fell he. Squirmed and struggled and gurgled and guggled, I drew my snigger snee. My snigger snee. Oh, never shall I forget the cry or the shriek that shrieked me as I gnashed my teeth when from its sheath I drew my snigger snee.
Came on an entirely different matter. A year ago, my son, the heir to the company, bolted from our Imperial Club.
Indeed, had he any reason to be dissatisfied with his position?
None whatever. On the contrary, I was going to marry him, yet he fled.
Oh, I'm surprised he should have fled from one so lovely.
That's not true.
No.
You hold that I'm not beautiful because my face is plain. Mm. But you know nothing. You are still unenlightened. Mm. Learn, then, that it is not in the face alone where beauty is to be sought. My face is unattractive.
It is?
But I have a left shoulder blade. It is a miracle of loveliness. People come miles to see it. My right elbow has a fascination that few can resist.
Allow me.
It is on view Tuesdays and Fridays on the presentation of a club membership card. As for my circulation, it is the widest in the world.
And yet he fled.
And is now masquerading in this town, disguised as a second trombone.
A second trombone?
Yes. Would it be troubling you too much if I asked you to produce him? He goes by the name of...
Nanky Poo.
Nanky Poo.
It's very easy.
And that is to say it's rather difficult. You see, he's gone abroad.
Gone abroad? His address?
A Kathmandu!
What's the matter?
See here, Nanky Poo, beheaded this morning. Oh, where shall I find another? Where shall I find another?
Oh, dear. This is very tiresome, my good fellow. In your anxiety to carry out our wishes, you have beheaded the heir to the Mikado.
I beg to offer an unqualified apology.
We had the least notion.
I desire to associate myself with that expression of regret.
Of course. Come, good fellow. If a man of exalted rank chooses to disguise himself as a second trombone, well, then he must take the consequences. It really distresses me to see you take on so. I'm sure he thoroughly deserved all he got.
Madam, we are infinitely obliged to your excellency.
Much obliged, your excellency.
Very much obliged.
Obliged? Not a bit. Don't mention it. How could you tell?
No, of course we couldn't tell who the gentleman really was.
It wasn't written on his forehead, you know.
Oh, he might have been on his handkerchief. But club members don't use handkerchiefs.
I forget the punishment for compassing the death of the heir apparent.
Punishment?
Yes, something lingering with boiling oil in it, I fancy. Something of that sort, but I'm not quite sure. I know it's something humorous. With either boiling oil or melted lead. Come, don't fret. I'm not a bit angry.
If your excellency would say would accept our assurance, we really had no idea.
Of course.
But we knew nothing about it.
That's the pathetic part of it. Unfortunately, the fool of a rule says... Now then, let me see. Yes, there we are. Compassing the death of the heir apparent. There's not a word about a mistake.
No.
Or not knowing.
No.
Or having no notion.
No.
Or not being there.
No.
There should be, of course.
Yes!
But there isn't. That's the slovenly way in which these acts are always drawn. Never mind, cheer up. I'll have it amended at the next AGM. Now then, shall we see about this execution of yours, shall we? Will after luncheon suit you? Can you wait till then?
Oh, yes.
Yes, we can wait till then.
Good. Then we'll make it after luncheon.
I don't want any lunch.
I'm sure I'm very sorry for you all. But it's an unjust world, and virtue is triumphant only in theatrical performances.
See how the fates their gifts allot. For A is happy, B is not, yet E is worthy, I dare say, of more prosperity than A.
Is B more worthy?
I should say.
Oh, so happy, loving, chopping, nectar quaffing, ever joyous, ever gay, happy, undeserving, ever joyous, ever gay, happy, undeserving. If I were fortune, which I'm that is as human I am be. But should A perish, that should be, of course, assuming I am B. B should be happy, oh so happy, laughing, ha ha, chuffing, ha ha, nectar grumpy, ha ha ha. But condemned to die is he, wretched meritorious B. But condemned to die is he, wretched meritorious B.
Nodding head and preference due to a man of pedigree?
Merely corroborative detail, intended to give artistic verisimilitude to an otherwise bald and unconvincing narrative.
Cooperative detail indeed! Cooperative fiddlestick!
Oh, you're just as bad as he is, what with you're catching his eye and he's whistling an air. But that's so like you, you must put in your oar.
But how about your big right arm?
Yes, and just snicker sneeze.
Oh, never mind about that now. There's only one thing to be done. Nanki Poo hasn't started yet. He shall have to come back to her. Ah! Nanki Poo! I've got good news for you. You're a reprieve.
Oh, it's too late now. I'm a gentleman and I'm off on my honeymoon.
Nonsense! A terrible thing has just happened. It seems that you're the son of the Mikado.
Yes, but that happened some time ago.
Is this a time for airy persiflage? Your father's here, and with Katisha.
My father, and with Katisha?
Yes, he wants you, particularly.
So does she.
Oh, but he's married now.
Well, heavens, what have that got to do with it?
Katisha claims me in marriage, but she can't marry me now because I'm married already. Therefore, she will insist upon my execution, and if I'm executed, my wife will be given a concrete overcoat.
You see our difficulty, don't you?
Yes. Do you know, I really don't know what's to be done.
There's one chance. If you were to persuade Katisha to marry you, she shall have no further claim on me, and I could come to life again without any fear of being put to death.
I? Marry Katisha?
I really think it's your only course.
My dear girl, have you seen her? She's something appalling.
Ah, that's only her face. She has a left elbow that people come miles to see.
I am told her right heel is much admired by connoisseurs.
My good sir, I decline to pin my heart on any lady's right heel.
When it comes to this, while Katisha is single, I prefer to remain a disembodied spirit. Once Katisha is married, existence will be as welcome as the flowers in spring.
The flowers that bloom in the spring, tra-la, bring glories of merry sunshine. As they merrily dance and we sing, tra-la, be welcome the hope that they bring, tra-la, for the summer of the roses and wine, for the summer of the roses and wine. And that's what we mean when we say that a thing is welcome as flowers that bloom in the spring. Tra-la-la-la, tra-la-la-la-la, the flowers that bloom in the spring.
The flowers that bloom in the spring, tra-la, have nothing to do with the kiss. I've got to take under my wing, tra-la, a most unattractive old thing, tra-la, with a caricature of a face, with a caricature of a face. And that's what I mean when I say or I sing. Oh, bother the flowers that bloom in the spring. Tra-la-la-la-la, tra-la-la-la-la, oh, bother the flowers in spring.
To wait.
To rob me of my love. But vengeance is mine. The concrete is ready mixed.
Kedisha! Behold a suppliant at your feet! Kedisha! Mercy!
Mercy? Had you mercy on him? See here, you. You have slain my love. He didn't love me, but he would have loved me in time. I'm an acquired taste. Only the educated palate can appreciate me. I was educating his palate when he left me. Well, now he's dead. Where shall I find another? It takes years to train a man to love me. Must I go through the weary round again, while at the same time imploring mercy for he who robbed me of my brain? I mean my pupil. Just when his education was on the point of completion. Oh, where shall I find another? Where shall I find another?
Here!
What?
Kedisha. For years I have loved you with a white-hot passion which is slowly but surely consuming my very vitals. Ah, shrink not from me! If there is aught of woman's mercy in your heart, turn not away from a lovesick suppliant whose every fibre thrills at your tiniest touch. True it is that under a poor mask of disgust I have endeavoured to conceal a passion whose inner fires are broiling the soul within me. But the fires will not be smothered. Kedisha! I dare not hope for your love, but I will not live without it. Darling!
You, whose hand is still weeping from the blood of my betrothed, dare to speak words of love to the woman you so foully wronged?
I do, except I love her, I perish on the spot.
Nobody knows as well as I that nobody yet died of a broken heart.
You know not what you say. Listen.
On a tree by a river, a little tomtit sang willow, tit, willow, tit, willow. And I said to him, Dickie bird, why do you sit singing willow, tit, willow, tit, willow? Is it weakness, Elvie?
titwillow, titwillow. He sobbed and he sighed as he sat on that bough, singing willow, titwillow, titwillow. And a cold perspiration bespangled his brow. Oh, willow, titwillow, titwillow. He sobbed and he sighed, and a gurgle he gave. Then he plunged himself into the billowy wave.
And an echo arose from the suicide's grave.
Oh, willow, titwillow, titwillow. Now I feel just as sure as I'm sure that my name is Willow, Titwillow, Titwillow. That was blighted affection that made him exclaim, oh, Willow, Titwillow, Titwillow. And if you remain callous and obdurate, I shall perish as he did, and you shall know why. Though I probably shall not exclaim as I die. Oh, willow, titwillow, titwillow. Yes.
Poor little chap.
Yes, it's quite an affecting tale and quite true. I knew the bird intimately.
Did you? He must have loved him very much.
His devotions were something extraordinary.
Poor little chap. And if I refuse you, will you go and do the same?
At once!
Oh, no, no, you mustn't, you mustn't. Oh, I am a silly little goose. And you won't mind if I'm just that wee little bit bloodthirsty, will you?
Oh, mind it, Katisha. Is there not even beauty in bloodthirstiness?
My idea exactly. There's beauty in the bellow of the blast. There's grandeur in the howling of the gale. There's an eloquent uproaring when the lion is roaring and the tiger is lashing of his tail.
Yes, I like to see a tiger from the Congo to the Niger, but especially when the lashing of its tail.
Volcanoes have a splendor that is grim, and earthquakes only terrify the dogs. But to him who's scientific, there is nothing less terrific in the falling of the fight of thunderbolts.
Yes, in spite of all my meekness, if I have a little weakness, it's a passion for a flight of thunderbolts. If that is so simple, now very simple, very old, take someone away from the world. Enough. Information I'm requesting on the subject interesting is the maiden all the better when she's tough.
And my dominion, there's a general opinion that she'll last a good deal longer when she's tough.
I'm lucky enough to marry, do you think? Won't you wait until you're 80 in the shade? There's a fascination frantic in the room that's romantic. Do you think you are sufficiently decayed?
On the subject that you mention, I have given some attention, and I think I am sufficiently decayed.
If that is so simple, now very simple, very old, it's so fun. We will go and marry and marry your tiny 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 tiny.
Bye.
ready. Have all the painful preparations been made?
All is prepared, Your Excellency.
Then produce the unfortunate gentleman and his two well-meaning but misguided accomplices.
Mercy! Mercy for Pity Singh, mercy for Coco, mercy even for Pooh Bob.
I beg your pardon? I don't think I quite caught that remark.
Mercy even for Pooh Bob.
My husband-to-be is no longer, and I've just got to marry this miserable little wretch.
I see. You've not been very long about it.
We were married before the registrar.
I am the registrar.
I see. But my problem is that as you have executed the heir of the Mikado...
The heir of the Mikado is not executed.
Bless my heart, my son!
And your daughter-in-law, elected. Traitor, you have deceived me!
Yes, I think you are entitled to an explanation, but I think he will give it better whole rather than in little pieces.
You see, Your Excellency, it's like this.
Yeah.
It is true that I had stated that I had killed Nanki Poo.
With most affecting particulars.
Merely corroborative detail. Intended to give artistic verisimilitude to otherwise...
Oh, will you refrain from putting in your all? You see, it's like this. When Your Excellency says let a thing be done, it's as good as done. Mm-hmm. Practically it is done, because Your Excellency's rule is law.
Quite so.
Your Excellency says, kill a gentleman. And that gentleman is told off to be killed. Consequently, that gentleman is as good as dead. Practically, he is dead. And if he is dead, why not say so?
I see. Well, then, nothing could possibly be more satisfactory.
For he's gone and married young, young. Your anger may marry, for all will be merry. I think you had better succumb.
Come,
and join our expressions of glee.
On this subject, I pray you be dumb. Your notions, though many, are not worth a penny. The word for your guidance is mum.
Mum,
you've a very good bargaining.
On this subject, I pray you be dumb.